Billy, we need you back in Santa Cruz. Come on.
Hey, welcome to Issues 2010. This is a new political talk show where we're going to try to meet some candidates and get to the heart of some of the key issues here in Santa Cruz. We're going to meet some people out on the streets. We're going to meet some famous celebrities. We're going to go overseas and meet all kinds of wonderful guests. We're also going to be bringing in people in here, and we're going to talk to them face to face and get right to the true issues. Of course, none of this is scripted. I don't have a teleprompter. I can even talk to you with my eyes closed. This is so wonderful. We're live, folks. And so if we make a mistake, please accept our apologies, but we're going to just get through this and do the best we can. You know, some of the things that are issues today for this show is our wonderful president going in front of the American people and telling them that they need courage. And I've been wondering, you know, we've had a pretty tough time these last 10 years. As far as I know, the recession started back in 2003, and here in Santa Cruz, his business has been dropping like flies ever since. And so now he comes on TV and says, folks, you need to have courage. Does that mean things are going to get worse? Oh, please. Nothing, it can't get any worse. We got to start on this road to recovery. And part of that is getting to the key of these issues and getting people like our candidates here to talk about them. And of course, I'm no politician. I'm just an average John Doe, just like you guys at home. And so I think by coming to you at this level, it's going to be not only educational for me, but it'll be educational for you. And when I talked to those people out on the streets, it was really amazing some of the things that are considered the issues today. And although we don't have that tape footage today, we're still editing it down for future episodes. All you people we talked to, thank you, and we really do appreciate you being available to come out and help us on this project. So anyway, my first guest is all the way from Afghanistan. I can't thank him enough for coming to us live via satellite, and here we are with the Afghan drug lord, Chris Baba. Chris Baba, welcome to the show.
Salaam alaikum. I'm so happy to be here.
So, Mr. Baba, if you don't mind, how have things been since the Americans have taken over your country?
Oh, Sandra, it's wonderful here. Our economy's growing. The CIA and the army's blowing everything up and causing all this. And more armies coming. We have plenty of body bags to ship our heroin back. Our poppies are blooming. International business has gone up. The price of heroin has gone down in all your markets. Thank you very much, Obama and the Bush administration. We love you.
That's great. I knew that things would be good. All my buddies at Pfizer and GlaxoSmithKline have been just tickled pink that you've been allowing the imports of opium and heroin and morphine back to our states. You know, the pharmaceutical companies were having real trouble getting their drugs until we got rid of the Taliban. And now with your brother Karzai, I think things are doing real well. Actually, how have things been now without the Taliban? And your women are being educated and getting to get out in society. How's that going?
Well, since the Taliban have left, of course, there was very heavy on the women. Before that, the Mahajin, everything was cool. The Taliban came, the religious thing, and now these new ones, oh, just are working with the Bush administration and all of these puppets for the oil manufacturers, pharmaceutical companies. We're putting a Walmart here in Afghanistan, and we're going to trade heroin for pharmaceuticals. Oh, it's wonderful. Economy is growing. It's beautiful.
Oh, okay then. So I see behind you there that your village has just been completely destroyed. How do you feel about that? I mean, that must bother you.
Oh, this is great. This is going to be renovation. We'll be able to put casinos in here. We'll be able to get all our women being American sluts and hanging out and smoking cigarettes in the marketplace. It's going to be wonderful. We'll all have economy. The elite from all over the world will be able to come here and party and smoke the best hash in the land, primo and opium from Afghanistan.
Well, I know I can't wait to get my package. And thank you so much for taking the time to join us today on Issues 2010. I hope to talk to you in the future, but you never know. We wish you nothing but the best. Chris Baba, Afghan drug lord. Well, folks, see, you kind of got the feel for where we're heading with all this. We're going to kind of take a serious but lighthearted look at politics, or maybe you could call it a seriously lighthearted look at politics. You make up that mind. All I can do is bring it to you, and I hope you enjoy it. So now I'm going to get to my first guest with the light brown apple moth eradication program. We got to stop that spraying. And so here we are. We're going to talk to Seal. And so here we are with Seal from the
People Against Chemical Trespass.
Seal, thank you so much for coming down today. This is a really important issue to us here in Santa Cruz. You know, this light brown apple moth thing has been a big farce, and the only people that are making any money are the big chemical companies, and of course, the politicians that signed this into bill. Seal, tell us, where do we stand right now with this crazy program?
Well, it's really getting interesting, because while prior to last week, the California Department of Agriculture would say that the light brown apple moth caused millions of dollars worth of damage at their press conferences.
And who says this?
The California Department of Agriculture, CDA. They had to publish an environmental impact report, and that's something that's subject to judicial review. And in the report, they state there was no damage caused by the light brown apple moth.
Beautiful.
Now, we kind of knew that beforehand, and I just want to say that my background is that I've gone back to college, and I'm studying horticulture at Cabrillo. And we go on field trips as students to various farms in the area. We had not found one farmer that had ever had any damage from a light brown apple moth. However, nearly every farmer we spoke to either had experienced a quarantine or knew someone who'd experienced a quarantine, and the quarantines cost the farmers up to $100,000 or more in lost revenue, and this costs the state in lost tax dollars. So I'm really glad that you mentioned large chemical corporations, because we know they were heavy contributors to our current governor's campaigns.
Absolutely. Now, do you have any names of any of these companies? Can we point some fingers?
Well, let me tell you, I've got a stack of papers here. However, I decided, since this is a humorous show, that I wasn't going to bring up specifics like that. I am going to give you the website for People Against Chemical Trespass, and you can go there and get all the dirt.
Perfect, perfect, folks. So that's something that you need to do, because there's a lot of corruption going on. And as far as I know, this isn't the first time that these same people have pulled this. I remember back in the early 80s, after a concert I was working on, we went hot tubbing and overflew about 6 or 7 helicopters spraying for med flies. And it was the same baloney. There's no fields in Santa Clara that needed to be sprayed, especially over the mobile homes and business sections. But yet they were flying night after night, spending millions and millions of our taxpayer dollars. Do we have any idea what the figures are so far on this thing?
No, I don't. But I'm sure that the website will provide links for that kind of information. I'm going to take every single question back and make sure that we provide answers for that. I do want to comment that we're asking for the standard to be the same for this sort of activity. If you want to spray chemicals that you don't identify, and up to 95% of the material in the aerial spray is what they call inert ingredients, and they don't need to be identified. So,
and that's like all kinds of crazy stuff, like potassium and citric acids, and you know, just you wouldn't even you'd be amazed of all the kinds of things they throw in there as inert. And you know, most of it's water and then oil substances, but this little things that they throw in there, you know, we wonder why we're getting skin cancer, and we're wondering why we're having all these other problems with our environment. And here at Community TV, you know darn well that we want to get to the bottom of these lies and corruptions, and hopefully this can do it. God bless you for all the work you're doing.
Yeah.
So what can me and our viewing audience do today?
Well, first is, like I said, demand the same standard. And that is the way, for example, a doctor would take care of an illness. He would evaluate the situation. He or she would diagnose what the problem was and then prescribe something to take care of it. We don't feel there's been adequate evaluation. We're not sure there's even been a very good diagnosis because there's no evidence of damage. But the prescription came out not only for the light brown apple moth, but the state has come out with a list of 20 pests that they wish to eradicate. And what I've learned at Cabrillo in my pest management class was that you don't go and eradicate pests. The first thing you want to look at is what kinds of things do you have that might keep this insect or rabbit or toad, the population in a manageable amount.
Well, you know, I'm going to interrupt because, you know, we came to this planet not by ourselves. All these other creatures that inhabit this planet, and I'm going to try to touch on this on every show if I can, but we're all here for a reason, that we all have to work together, that every little insect has its purpose. And one of the things that's driving me crazy right now is that we have this bee dilemma. We don't have any bees to pollinate our plants. You know, but I live out in the fields, and I'm lucky if I see three or four anymore. And so, you know, we've got to stop this, and that's the bottom line. We've got to get to the end of this. We've got to have people like Seal. We've got to have people like you at home caring about these issues. The main important thing, folks, is that we all get together. You know, I might be one person, but now there's you and me and Seal. And we all care. We all care about where we live. We all care about how the future of this world's going to be. And so together we can make a difference. Seal, thank you so very much for coming down tonight.
Thank you.
I look forward to seeing you again in the future and wish you nothing but the best with your project.
And our website's going to be up at the end of the show, and you can get actions you can take. We're going to go from a local ordinance to statewide ballot proposition because we're not the only community this is happening to. And so we started very specific with Santa Cruz, and now we're going statewide.
Hello, my loyal subjects. Thank you so much for joining me this evening on this royal occasion. I come to you tonight to thank all of my wonderful loyal subjects. You have been so caught up in the healthcare debate that you completely forgot about my funding for the war. And this healthcare debate, by the way, is a win-win situation for the insurance companies. And you're damned if we do and damned if you don't. So you keep worrying about that healthcare. Oh, and I mean, we'll keep funding that war. The healthcare issue. Yeah, the healthcare issue is very important because you need healthcare, and we're going to make you buy it because you need to have it. And so just like car insurance, whether you get into accidents or not, we're going to make you have it. And guess what else? We're going to make it that you can get insurance no matter how sick you are. But I'm not going to tell you how much it costs. Oh, no, we're not going to tell you. So anyway, loyal subjects, thank you so much for joining me. I'm sure you'll forget about this whole issue by tomorrow, and there'll be something else that you'll worry about that's even less important. So good night, and God bless you all. And so this is our Meet the Politician segment. This is probably going to be one of the funnest things that I'm going to get to do. This is where I get to meet some of the candidates running for office and get the spilly feel for what their positions are. And tonight to join me is Mark Half Moon. He's running for city council this year, boys and girls, and I think it's really cool that he took the time out to come on our show and talk about things. Mark, thank you so much.
Well, thanks for having me here. You said meet the politicians. Where's the politician?
Well, you're one now, whether you like it or not.
Oh,
you're going to have to transition into this world.
You know, and it's good to actually announce my planned candidacy on your show. Now, it's a planned candidacy because it's not really a candidacy until... I think the deadline is in June to file the papers. I think that's when it's done. And I'm planning to file those papers and to become a candidate for Santa Cruz City Council.
Beautiful.
In June. Part of the reason is because I've been a resident of Santa Cruz for decades, for many years. All my children were born here. I made this my home. I grew up, my kids all grew up here, and I made it my home because it's beautiful, and there's a lot of beautiful people here, and I love it. And I love the attitude and who we consider ourselves to be as Santa Cruzans. We're compassionate people. We care about social issues. We care about what's happening to our fellow human beings. And one of the things that disturbs me, though, is the fact that all of my adult children who were born and raised in Santa Cruz have moved away. They've had to move away because they can't afford to live here.
It's a crisis.
Either the jobs pay too little, and that in combination with the housing is so expensive. And we talk a lot about affordable housing in Santa Cruz, but we don't really talk about affordable rents. We're usually talking about affordable housing to buy. So anyway.
But when they say affordable housing, they're still talking $400,000. That ain't affordable to me.
It ain't affordable to
a whole lot of people that I know. And the people that think they can afford that are even having problems. And so, yeah, no, it's just incredible. And it all revolves around that greed issue. And people just want to try to make a buck. And then those people that might have bought their house 25 years ago, 30 years ago, and are paying maybe a $200, $300 a month mortgage, are going around and turning around and renting that house out for $1,200, $1,500, and just so they can pad their own pockets and not thinking about how it affects society in a whole. It's really a shame, Mark. But let's talk about some of the issues here in Santa Cruz that we need to address.
Okay.
One of the things is lower income housing. We're very lucky, and I think, you know, Santa Cruz has probably done a lot more than other communities to provide adequate housing for low-income people, but the demand is just so overwhelming, and it's just a drop in the bucket what they're doing for us. Mm-hmm. Do you think there's people out there and organizations that are going to be trying to help a little more?
I think so. And in fact, that is what we need to do. As a city, I think the leaders of the city need to listen to people who study these things and who look into them a lot. Now, I believe that the University of California is a major issue in this housing issue. They bring thousands of people here and usually temporary residents, often. Many of them stay, but the university needs to step up and take a larger role in helping to not just create more housing, but have a being a good neighbor.
I so agree. And you know, I've spent quite a bit of time up there on the campus, both in the accounting department and out with the students. And I know for a fact that they pretty much set the standard for what people charge for rents. You know, they put four people in a place and charge each one of them $500. You know, that's $2,000 they're getting for one apartment. And that means that the people down the street that are getting $1,500, that's a super deal, and the kids are lining up at their doorstep, so they'll charge $1,700. It's all about the school up there, and they sure have a lot of leeway to drop the prices the way they pack kids in there.
I agree. And there are a lot of other, as you just had, a lot of other really important issues. Now, I don't want to be one of these people, and why I made the joke about where's the politician, is that often what happens with politicians is that they tend to approach things as if, I have all the answers, I know everything. And what I'm more interested in is having politicians or elected officials who are willing to listen to people, like, I have my own ideas. I have very strong political ideas on various issues. But that doesn't mean I can't be persuaded and that my ears are not open to other things. I may be biased in the way that I look at some issues, but I think it's very important as a journalist and therefore as a candidate to be fair, to listen fairly to what people have to say, and to realize that I've come to my points of view and my ideas from my lifelong experience, and I believe in them. And not to assume that the people who have different points of view than I and may want something different than I want to happen, that they're just being malicious or anything. They have a lifetime of experiences that have informed them to have that opinion. And what I want to see is more civility in our city council. I'd like to see, I don't want to see any segment of our community shut out. I'd like to hear people.
It was getting carried away there, Mark, for a couple years, you know, and I'm lucky I'm going to have Mike Rockin on my next show, the mayor, but for a few years there, you couldn't go to a city council meeting and not be upset by the way they were handling things. And I think they so need some fresh blood in there. And I'm so glad that you're interested in doing this, because it's going to take people like you that are, you know, people that are down to earth, not involved with the major corporations, to go in there and change their attitudes. You know, pretty much everybody in there is involved with a big corporation of some sorts. UCSC, their own businesses. And again, you know, I salute you, privately owned business owners. You're the best. I can't thank you enough for struggling through these tough economic times. But it's us people down here, the working people, that are getting minimum wage these days to get by, which is not enough. You know, we can't support your stores when we can't even support ourselves. And so I think there's got to be a big change as far as how people look at our society and the lower class, and as opposed to how can we take them to the cleaners, either through raising our parking tickets, raising our traffic tickets, raising our sales taxes, raising tuitions, put it on the charge card, let the banks get the interest. And you know, well, I'm not going to take your time up on that, but we've got so many things here that need to be addressed locally. And I think pretty much, Mark, you'll be surprised that the people out on the streets really want you guys to succeed. They want our politicians to take that extra step and to make that change. No.
What do you find to be some of the more pressing issues in the city of Santa Cruz?
Well, here in the city of Santa Cruz, it's really, you know, most of the people are feeling that it's the big federal issues, the health care issue, the schooling funding issues, the past government has just been run. You know, there's still a lot of angst.
Your previous guest was talking about the LBAM spraying, the light apple, light brown apple moth spraying that went on last year and is threatened to happen again this year, when it seems clear that a majority of the people don't want this unknown substance to be sprayed on them, especially when they don't know what the what's inside it, what's in it, and as far as all the studies have shown, that there's really been no impact by this moth that's considered a threat.
It's crazy, Mark. It's just crazy. Well, you know what? We're out of time for this segment tonight, but what we're going to do, Mark, is we're going to have you back on a couple more times before we get to the election, as we find out what the ballot measures are and what people are talking about. Hopefully you'll come back on my show and spend some more time so we can get down to those key things.
I'll be happy to.
Thank you, Mark. Thank you so much, and good luck to you.
Thank you.
All right. Well, we're going to wrap up the show here with another one of my great guests. He's a relative, just like all my other guests, pretty much. And Uncle Spunky is going to just wrap things up with WTF with Uncle Spunky. Hey, folks, you know what really pisses me off? I tell you, it's when there's people standing on television telling me what I want. I mean, there's these guys in Washington, and they think they know what I want. Well, I tell you, look at these guys. The Three Stooges. I mean, come on. Do they know what I want? Do those guys have any clue what I want? I want universal health care, the good shit that they got. I want cheap gas prices, not $3 a gallon. I want kids to go to school and not have to owe the banks their entire lives' fortunes just to get an education that you used to get in high school. That's the kind of stuff I want. I mean, what the? Come on, boys and girls and folks, you know better than that. There's all kinds of things that we can do to make this planet a better place, but none of you are doing it. I mean, look at 9/11, for Christ's sakes. Half of you people don't even believe it happened. No, we blew the place up. That's right, Bush and Cheney, they blew it up, and you didn't even know. Well, guess what? has happened, and we got to deal with it. So you know what, folks? I sure hope that tomorrow's a better day today, and we'll talk to you next show. Good night.